always two there are. No more, no less. A master and an apprentice.
Oh god, I was thinking at the beginning the bit where like Robin's pinned Slade in his dreams, like, is he gonna take off his mask and see Robin's own? Yep, he's gonna take off his mask and it's Robin's face under there.
As you do.
Also can't tell you how much of this episode I spent yelling, it's a trap! At my computer, because I'm at the point in my life where I can't phrase that any other way.
Honestly, that's so cliched at this point that I would probably intentionally not phrase it that way.
There was a time I could have resisted phrasing it that way, but that was before The Force Awakens and Rogue One. I will say, I've heard of this plot. I don't know how it ends, but I have in fact heard of this. So I kind of started realizing where this was going to go about halfway through the episode. That by no means undermined how this episode went, because this was a spectacularly tense episode. And Slade is an extremely good villain. Like, I'm giving him all the villain brownie points at this point. He's doing it all very well.
Yes.
Because the great thing about a smart, competent villain is that it just makes your heroes that much cooler when they kick his ass.
Yeah. So in this episode, Apprentice, Slade ends up calling Titan's Tower directly to show off a chronoton detonator he has. This can cause time to be frozen permanently in an area. Slade taunts them to find it, which pisses Robin off. But before he can run off to stop it, Raven at least is able to analyze the video to find out that it is at the docks. When they check the exact place it was shown on the video, only Slade's robots are there. They, or Robin, rather, defeat them, only to start searching elsewhere. Robin furiously interrogates a nearby civilian, but is quickly stopped by Raven for getting out of hand, I guess. Before an argument can start about this, Starfire's allergies act up. Okay. That happened.
It was so cute.
She is conveniently allergic to chromium, which is found in the very device they're looking for. So they use her allergies to try to find the source, which ends up being in the sewers, in a boat, guarded by Slade's men. Robin is attacked and distracted by Cinderblock before he can follow the others. He beats Cinderblock and then uses the device Cinderblock had to follow Slade. Meanwhile, the other Titans are eventually able to stop the boat, but now have to deal with disabling the device. But when Robin encounters Slade, and after some fighting, it becomes apparent that there was no chronoton detonator, which then falls apart. The Titans are attacked by some sort of weapon that seemingly didn't do anything to them, outside of knocking them into the water. However, it ends up putting probes into their bloodstream that Slade can activate to destroy them at any time. So, in order to prevent that, Slade forces Robin to become his apprentice. Ending the episode.
See, that was like a minute and a half. That was like 2 minutes of summary, but it still feels too short for what all went down in this episode.
Kind of, yeah.
I'm also gonna have to go back and add like a counter for every time I yelled, "That is obviously a trap!"
I know, right?
But I mean, going back to the beginning, for some reason, something about the kind of low-key, surreal way they designed the landscape immediately triggered my this-is-a-dream opening thought.
Yeah,
like,
kind of.
Quite groovy background music, but by the time they were at the stone circle, it was definitely like, okay, this is a dream. What is this going to foreshadow or reveal to us about Robin? Yeah, his Empire Strikes Back moment where he sees his own face under Slade's mask was, I think, actually a reasonably good follow-up of Starfire accusing Robin of behaving like Slade, and good foreshadowing of what Slade's been up to this whole time with all his creeping on Robin.
Yeah.
Also, even though I already knew it was a dream sequence, I was still wincing when they're knocking down the stone circle, so I'm like, that is such bad juju. Like, oh, at best, you've probably pissed off some fairies. Like... Don't knock down stone circles, especially when the stones are in fact statues of your friends. That extremely subtle symbolism is something you should do.
The symbolism is more complex than Utena.
Okay, I'll give Utena this. Its symbolism was often complex, but subtle it was not.
True.
I mean, Robin wakes up and I'm like, you sleep in your mask, you paranoid little shit. But this is like the last point in the episode where he's actually sufficiently paranoid to keep up with Slade and general progress of events. I mean, like, immediately after the dream when Cyborg says, it's Slade, and then it goes into the title sequence, which is in English, I'm like, ooh, this is going to be a plot episode. Boy, howdy is it.
It certainly is. So the first thing I want to point out is that Ron Perlman is the best.
God, yeah. He's so creepy as Slade. Like, part of it is just he's consistently calm. And something about the growl in his voice regularly brings to mind the word seductive about his performance. Which,
yes.
Given that it's primarily directed at Robin, is just super fucking creepy.
I know, right?
I mean, I know it's all very much seducing Robin to the dark side and all that, but, there's some undeniable predator undertones there as well at this point. I thought I was reading too much into it, but at this point, it's pretty fucking predatory. And yeah, he's a really good villain in this. Because he's so on top of literally everything that happens in this episode.
Yeah, he's always one step ahead.
Yeah. I mean, to start with, he knows the Titan's phone number, which he probably should not. Christ, I just realized the pun. He had a time bomb. Jesus.
Yes, he had a time bomb.
He had a time bomb. Which wasn't even a real bomb. The whole thing was, it's a trap!
Also, to add to that, there should be entire essays about why Slade's mask is so damn cool.
Yeah.
Just, like, just of the fact that it's, like, half black with nothing and half brown with just one eye. Just so cool.
I mean, I do just kind of love the fact that in, like, any incarnation, he has one eye, so he just went, well, gonna just make that mask a little bit more streamlined. And the grill thing for his mouth, it helps him look just really freaking sinister.
Yes.
And, yeah, like you said, half the mask being just smooth black gives him that constant look of being half in the shadows. Shrouded in darkness. I will say, the one bit of this episode that I deeply could not take seriously, and it's not the episode's fault, I can just never take this seriously, is the part where, like, Raven enhances the reflection to find out where they are.
Yeah.
I can literally never take enhancing reflection seriously. And even this was a relatively good case where it's able to, you know, extrapolate from reasonably abstract shapes, just some very simple line shapes as in the big letters. That's so much better than most shows that try to pull us enhancing reflection shit.
Yeah.
But I just... I can never take it seriously, ever.
I know, right? Like, I love how there's a thing... Like, there's basically a program to just automatically take the text and then reverse it so that it shows you exactly what it is.
Well, it's a reflection-enhancing program, obviously.
Clearly.
Though a lot of this episode, I kept thinking... I vote Raven for team leader. She is, like, in charge and on top of things this episode.
Yes, yes, she is.
Like, I mean, she's the one who does the reflection enhancing. She's the one who actually, you know, stops Robin storming off and going, maybe we should check the video for somewhere to look. Later when Robin's going a bit, you know, a bit excessive on questioning that poor dock worker guy, Raven's the one that pulls him off. And she figures out a way to contain Starfire's adorable explosive sneezes.
Yes.
So just, Raven is in charge this episode, I love it.
Yes, he is.
And then they make their totally stealthy entrance to where the bomb should be, and it's not, and it's obviously a trap.
Of course.
So it's like, I'm not sure if I should count this as like point, this is probably like point, one point up for it's obviously a trap. I will say the Slade's ninja bots, I realize what they remind me of. It's, have you ever seen Lupin III, Castle of Cagliostro?
Yes.
The Studio Ghibli one, yeah. Okay, the ninjas in that, with, you know, the claws and the dark armor and the masks.
Oh yeah, that is kind of like that.
Because, I mean, aside from the claws and the masks, they also move in the same, like, creepy, hunkered-over way. Especially when they're just kind of, like, sideways sliding out to reveal that they've been hidden behind, like, every vertical surface in the warehouse. It just really strongly put me in mind of the ninjas from Castle Cagliostro.
Yeah, that is kind of similar. Never thought of that.
Like, I don't know if it's a deliberate influence or not. There's definitely a fair bit of anime influence in this show, so I don't know if it's purposeful or not.
I mean, it might be. Because it's a Ghibli one, it's one that most people have seen, so it'd be reasonable to assume.
Yeah, I mean, it's the Lupin movie people are most likely to have seen, A, because it's Ghibli, and B, because it's the only one that's even a tiny bit child-friendly.
That too.
Well, I mean, unless you count the Conan crossovers. Even then, they're not totally child-friendly all the time. What with all the murders and everything. Anyway, so, they're fighting Cagliostro ninja bots, and Robin will not stop fucking kill-stealing.
Like, yes, that was great.
Kid needs to chill out. He needs to go get, like, a smoothie and massage or something, because he is just... He's going really Batman here with, like, 0% chill.
Yes, that's exactly what I was thinking of. When he was interrogating that guy, I thought he was just this close to hanging him upside down from a building.
And just going, "Where are they? Where's Slade? Where's the detonators? Where are they?"
Yeah, exactly.
And even, it's just this random civilian dude. It's like, Robin, for the love of God, it's just a random civilian. Stop throwing them at walls.
Yeah, that's probably not going to help.
And they're trying to argue that it's okay because he's the one trying to save the city. And it's like, yes, but you are being an asshole.
I do love that Starfire sneeze immediately just kills the tension of that.
I know.
And almost kills them, for that matter.
Yeah, it does. I love how, like, the second time she does it, like... Beast Boy is vanished into a drain and Robin is, like, ninja'd up a wall and Raven has just straight up gone into, a pocket dimension or something.
Yeah.
And I'd find it so weirdly adorable that she's just allergic to this rare metal that is a common allergy on her planet. And she just... And apparently she goes a bit nuclear when she's got the sniffles, which is probably good for the team to be aware of.
Yes.
Like, I don't know if aliens catch colds, although... According to H.G. Wells, it can kill him. But, you know, somebody get her a handkerchief, maybe?
I don't think that would help. I think the handkerchief would just explode.
Yeah.
But I do love that. Her allergies can define the device.
Yeah, that's great. I love that. It's so cute. And, yeah, so it's a bit... Tension's down for a little bit, and then, you know, they're walking the sewers, and Robin's even about to apologize to them, because he's kind of getting it to his head that he's being an asshole. And then they find the boat, and the wall blows up, and Robin's fighting Cinderblock, and he's like, "Chase the boat," and I'm going, "No, don't chase the boat! Robin has not been in control this whole episode, and Slade clearly has some creepy fixation on him. Leaving him alone will lead to no good plots." And I was right. But everyone else leaves him to fight this rock monster bastard while they go after the trap boat.
Also, at this point, I have to wonder if Robin doesn't actually have superpowers. Because did you see some of the stuff he did with that guy? He just He basically threw him to the ground. He just I'm not even sure what.
There's Aikido, and then there's this. But, no, I'm also going to point this as point two, obviously a trap, them chasing the boat, which appears to have been idling there for ages, but is now quite happy to leave the second it sees the Titans. Like, second point of it's a trap. I will also just, before we go back to talk about Robin's sideline, to say that, you know, like any good Supergirl fan, I am so into tiny, pretty characters being absurdly physically strong.
Yes.
Like, you know, Starfire very easily carrying Cyborg here, who looks like three times her size, but... I don't know, I love that kind of thing. So, they're following Trap Boat, and Robin, you know... Oh, I have to say, I also laugh pretty hard at, you know, the boat shoots at them, and Cyborg's just like, "I will not be having attitude from a boat!" Oh, he sounds so tired with his entire life. But, so we go back to point three of the most obvious trap in the episode, honestly, is, you know, Robin takes down Cinderblock, who just happens to be holding this tracker device, which has an obvious Slade insignia where Slade is.
Yeah.
Like, that could not be more of a trap if it was orbiting the forest moon of Endor. Oh my god, Robin. I thought you were raised by the most paranoid man on the planet. How do you not know that's a trap? Wow. Yeah, I'm not frustrated with the plotting or anything. I really enjoyed this episode. It's just one of those points where you're just like, "Oh, I know where this is going, and it's bad." It's like watching, rewatching Puella Magi, and any time Sayaka does anything, you're like, "No, Sayaka, don't! I can't save you, but I want to."
That'd be an interesting direction for the series to go.
Do you like to make a contract, Starfire?
Maybe my favorite little moment from this episode that just made me laugh is Cyborg's reaction when the device opened up. He just said, "Ooh." he's like he forgot to take it seriously at all. Like,
yeah, it's like, oh yeah, this is potentially a very dangerous weapon. Also, his way of stopping the boat is just ripping bits out of it, and I'm like, Cyborg, you were like 70% high-tech computer machinery. Surely you have a better method of deactivating something.
To be fair, that usually does deactivate it.
I mean, yeah, it did very effectively deactivate the boat. I'm not denying that.
Yeah.
I was like, we're switching back and forth between the team's kind of funny adventures in disarming a bomb. Because, like, pretty much none of that sequence is played particularly seriously, especially with Beast Boy's antics. But you're going back and forth between that and Robin fighting Slade over the, you know, fourth trap, obviously fake detonator. And the thing I think partially that unsettles me about this battle is the fact that there's... The theme music is very... I don't think relaxed is the good word for it. What am I saying? But it's like the theme music is very slow and very dark. And the fact that there isn't any adrenaline to it contributes to the air of it being a very one-sided battle. In this case, Slade is regularly making Robin's bones crunch, which is a sound effect that makes me ugh every time. You know, especially when he does that thing to his elbow and there's just a bone crunching noise. I'm just like, oh, that's not good. So yeah, that just the bone crunching sound effect really creeps me out every time.
Yeah, I can imagine. Like, there's nothing amusing about that, about this kid show with these little animated characters and they're just bone crunching.
Yeah, just, you know, unusually detailed shot of just Slade trying to bend Robin's elbow backwards. Oh, no, thank yes. you. So, you know, that all contributes to it looking like a really one-sided battle, and that just makes it all so creepy.
Yes, it does.
All the gear is in the background. It's reminding me of something really sinister, and I can't for the life of me think what.
Me either. I think it was just there. I don't even know why his lair has gears.
Like, I'm trying... Maybe it's Castle of Cagliostro again?
Maybe.
And there's all that fighting in the clock house, or... Maybe it's just because I watched Pan's Labyrinth recently, and clock gears were heavily associated with, can't remember his rank, but, you know, the evil guy.
The evil guy.
You know who I'm talking about.
Yeah.
If you've seen Pan's Labyrinth, anyway. So just, yeah, something about, you know, again, the color palette and all the gears in the background and the really calm background music just made it a really unsettling fight to watch. You just know Robin is not going to win this and it's all going to end horribly.
Yeah.
I mean, there is a bit where it seems like it's turned the tables and Robin is kicking Slade's ass, but again, the music hasn't changed. So I'm like, is this about Robin giving in to his hate and turning to the dark side of the Force? Or, no, it is shock and awe, it's a trap. He gets to the detonator and finds out it's not even real, and neither is the bomb. The whole thing was the most elaborate possible trap to get those frickin' explosive nanobots into everybody's blood.
Yes.
And it's like, I can't threaten your friends into doing anything, but I can threaten you. Which, again, I'm giving Slade all the evil brownie points for a thoroughly effective evil plan. I mean, just, you know, it's horrific, because now there's four teenagers probably about to die, and a fifth one who's having a pal around with this absolute fucking predator. But, you know,
yeah.
Well done on the tactical planning. Very impressed.
Yeah.
Also, I think I mentioned earlier, I have heard of this plot. Like, I don't know how it ends, but I have heard of this. And I was surprised to see it, like, what I thought of was as this early into the show. And then, you know, episode 12, I'm like, that's pretty early. And then I had to look up the episode list. It's like, oh, there's 13 episodes in the season. That's why this is the season finale.
Yeah.
I was expected to have, like, American-length seasons of, you know, like, 30 episodes, but no.
No. I mean, to be fair, I think there's series that have, like, 13-episode seasons, too. I mean, that's not too old. I mean, that's around the number they did for, like, some of the other DC shows, right?
I'm trying to remember.
I mean, it might have been a little bit more, but, like...
I think they were usually in their 20s per season. I'm gonna have to check this now. I have to know.
Honestly, nowadays, it feels like 13 episodes a season is probably around the norm.
It is these days. Oh, yeah, it was. Most of the Batman series, I think, had, like, 13. Well, I mean, like, the Batman the Animated series had, like, 30 episodes a season, and then Batman Beyond is, like, 12. So.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, these days it is more common, because, like, I think all four books of Legend of Korra were each, like, half the length of a last Airbender season.
Yeah, they were.
And part of that was just the administrative dickery around that show.
Of course. Yeah, we'll just give you one season. Okay, we'll give you four. Who decides that, by the way? That's just a random thing. Like, you made one of the most beloved shows of the past decade. Here's a season, and then just awkwardly just be like, okay, here's three more. Wait, what?
Yeah, I would be like, were they worried they couldn't give them free reign for some reason? But, I mean, they let them have bisexuals in the fourth season, so I don't know what they were scared of them doing if they gave them free reign.
I don't understand that at all.
Why would you not jump on the cash cow that is, like, automatically the sequel to one of the most successful Western cartoons of all time?
Yeah, I know, it's weird.
I will never know. But we're talking about the wrong cartoon now.
Yes.
So, Slade has a thoroughly effective evil plan. Well done. And he just gets increasing, especially silly about the way he says, don't worry, you'll learn to like it, when Robin's got the uniform on, is so fucking predatory.
Yeah, that's that was the one that came to mind. Like, ugh. Why would you say it like that? Though I'm amused when he said, when he just very calmly said, Robin, I've chosen you. Congratulations. It's like he won a prize.
And, you know, that's how Slade's trying to play it a bit. It's like, you've won the incredible honor of being my successor. Which, part of me is like, I'm sure Batman doesn't want people poaching his sidekicks, but the other part of me is like, I'm pretty sure they're keeping, like, all the adult heroes entirely out of the show and it's just the teenagers.
Yeah. Yeah, I think they're too busy fighting, like, that giant gorilla or something. Or trying to prevent Brainiac and Lex from meeting again or something.
I'd say, yeah, maybe Darkseid's around somewhere and they're all busy with that or something.
Yeah. It'd be funny if during this, on the other side of the country, was the whole, like, last season of Justice League battle or something.
Just Flash slips by at some point. They're like, Flash, we need help with Slade. Gotta go, killing Brainiac Luthor.
Yes. Exactly.
Oh, I don't know. But, oh, that was a really good episode. Yeah. I mean, I'm not talking about that Justice League Unlimited episode, though that was a good one, but just this episode of Teen Titans that we're supposed to be here to talk about. It was a really fucking good episode.
Yes, it was. I did love that Starfire sneezing almost doomed them all towards the end.
It was so cute.
I love that, and I love that when Raven, like, encapsulated her head to prevent it from affecting anything, it's just her hair was now all over the place.
Oh, yeah. And again, it's a moment where Raven is just absolutely on top of things. Everyone's like, oh god, we're gonna die, and she just bubbles Starfire's head. And,
yes.
And that works.
Maybe the most gloriously cheesy thing ever happened during the Super Serious Slade fight, when Robin fought back. At one point, the beatdown was so epic that lightning struck indoors.
Oh my god, yes. I remember that bit, and just watching it going, oh my god. Neither of them have lightning powers, there's a bolt of lightning.
Because
that's how epic this fight is now, officially.
Yes.
It has been blessed by lightning. Can't remind me of an early episode where everyone's arguing about something and Robin had just clearly waited for lightning to flash behind him before announcing that he was in the room and had a mission for everybody.
Like, yeah, he likes convenient lighting to make him look cool.
Yeah, like, again, you know, trained and raised by the king drama queen of the Justice League, so...
Yeah.
And, like, it was really cheesy, but at the same time, they'd managed to create such an unsettling air about that whole fight that it wasn't off-putting. Like, it wasn't distractingly cheesy. Like, you know, sometimes a cheesy or cliche thing happens and it throws you right out, and that wasn't what happened to you, because you're still just like, no way he's beating Slade now.
Yeah.
It was a to be continued! Like, my prediction so far is there's gonna be ages of Robin having to fight the Teen Titans or something, and be like, Robin, our friend, why are you doing this? And eventually, like, power of friendship or something will come through. I'm hoping not in, like, an overtly cheesy way, but quite simply in a, he's our friend and we know he wouldn't be doing this of his own will, so what's up?
Yes. Though I do find it, like, kind of clever that he has to team up with Slade after the previous time where he ended up fighting the Teen Titans in order to trick Slade.
Yeah, this is the thing. I'm wondering, are they going to use that? Are they going to be like, oh, well, maybe he's trying to trap Slade again? Maybe he's got a plan? And no.
He does have a plan to do this forever so that they don't die.
Basically. Which is a terrible plan to have to do, but...
Yes.
That is the plan.
But I think that's all we can really say about this one.
That was a lot we had to say about that one. And
exactly.
And I'm looking forward to watching the next one and finding out, you know, what happens.
Spoilers, everyone dies.
Everyone dies, and it turns out Dumbledore's a woman.
Yes.
But you're not going to find out till they tell you in an interview.
No. Slade was Dumbledore is a woman.
Ooh. Well, we haven't seen him under the mask yet.
That'd be the best plot twist.
Ooh.